Dreamwalkers and Dreamwalkettes, welcome to another episode of the TDW vlog for 2020. And let's just go right to the main subject. The live album is out!
Yay! Woohoo!
Arriva! It has taken a lot of time to get this album done, and it feels great to finally get it out there for all of you to hear. Obviously, I'm recording this video in advance, so I'm kind of giddy because I'm recording this on the Monday before the video actually premieres. But last Friday, the video went live. The complete concert is now available for all of you to see. The video will basically be available on YouTube forever from now, and it will be free, and it will remain free for all of you to see. Basically, what we guys ask you is, if you like the movie, if you like what you saw, please get this live CD, because that CD actually directly supports our future endeavors. And obviously, all the money that is made with this will be invested back into the band, because we're already working on a new album. We're in that whole writing and creative process. And obviously, you guys can contribute by, well, supporting us and getting yourself some cool music. So everybody wins, hey. I know that the last two vlogs have been kind of long. The interview was very long, and I quite like doing that. I want to do more of those interviews in the longer form, but also want to do some shorter videos. Not everything has to be a big essay. So this time I wanted to look into the production process of this live record, because people have been asking me a lot of questions. So what I want to do is just run through the production process really quickly, really basically, just to give you guys an impression of what is needed to create a live record and which steps you have to go through. So I divided this into multiple steps, and I will talk you through those. The starting point of this is the recording. We were lucky that we were playing a show last year on 31st of August in 2019 at this beautiful theater stage. So we were talking amongst ourselves like, hey, you know what we could do? We could just record it, and if it's not good enough, if we don't play well enough, or you know, if something is not up to snuff, then we can just use the recordings for our own use, just to look at it, listen to it, and improve. Or, if it's good enough, we might be able to make a release out of it. I personally think that if you want to take your band seriously, and if you want to get better as a musician, it never hurts to either record a show in audio or in video. Not just for release purposes, but really just to look at it and listen to it yourself. It's weird, and it's really hard. A part of me still has a hard time listening to my own recordings, because I'm like, oh, I'm doing everything wrong, and that note's wrong, and that note's wrong. But it is very good to look at what is actually happening. What are you saying? How are you looking at the audience? What are you doing interaction-wise? For me, video recordings, especially when they have decent audio, are a valuable treasure trove of self-improvement ideas. And honestly, every band I know, I always give them the same advice. And the first one is, get yourself in-ears to get better monitoring. But second, get yourself a camera or something to record your shows with. You don't have to release it on YouTube. Just do it for yourself, because you're able to see what you're doing and you can learn from that. Your showmanship and your musicianship will improve because of it. I can guarantee it. Now, in our case, we have our own in-ear setup, which we can also use for recording. And we mostly do it for quality control reasons. We just want to know, what are we doing? How does it sound? However, in this case, we were lucky, because at the venue, we had this wonderful guy called Steven Lowe, who was the live sound engineer as well, who had the ability to record the whole gig in multi-track. And this is also something I can advise to everyone. If you want to record your show, call the venue, call the sound guy, and ask if there maybe is an option for them to record it right from the desk. Because you'll get the best sound if you get it from the front of house in general, especially if you get it in separate tracks, because then you can actually make an album out of it like we did. So obviously the recording was something we did on the night itself. We also set up the cameras around the venue. I tend to do this all the time anyway, because I always bring one or two cameras with every show. Yes, it is a bit more extra work to set up those cameras, and yes, it is a bit more work to make sure that you can get an audio recording going, but it is something that is a worthy investment in my book, because it's always good to have an archive. It's always good to look at yourself, look at the stuff you've done, and realize where the improvements perhaps can be made, or maybe, you know, maybe that one time you're playing live, that one song just goes incredibly well, and then you have a recording of it, which is usable, and that's great. That's what you want. So then the second stage, after the recording and playing the live show at all, is the mixing. Now, mixing, obviously, is something that everyone does differently, and I'm not doing this video to tell you how to mix your record, because everyone has their own tastes, and there's no accounting for taste in that respect. However, I personally approach this record in a different way than making a studio album. Normally, when I make a studio album, I tend to be really gung-ho on all the details. I want to get every little detail right, which is obviously the expectation that the industry and listeners these days have from a studio album. However, for me personally, when doing a live record, it's not about perfection. For me, a live album should sound, as the word implies, live. It's a trend from the last couple of years that I've not really been understanding, because I've seen bands perform live, giving away great shows, really being into the show, and then hearing the recording of the same show and just not hearing the show at all, just hearing a polished studio recording that has everything evened out and tweaked to perfection and quantized and not. And I'm like, so why are you calling this a life record? Because basically this sounds like you're doing a studio record with a bunch of people going, yay, in between, you know? I prefer to have a life record sounding a bit raw, a bit more, well, a bit more angular, a bit more real, because then you get the impression that you're there, that it's a live show in which people also f*** up at times. Which brings us to the next point, the one question I get asked the most, did you guys re-record things for this live record? And the short answer is yes. Yes, we did. But not in the way that you would expect it to. Obviously, when you're recording live, you're playing a show once. It's not like you can do things over. And equipment has the unfortunate ability to fail. Just like, you know, just like people can fail, obviously. Everyone can make f*** ups, but equipment can f*** up too. There were multiple moments during this recording, and no one could do anything about that, might I remind you. There were multiple moments during this recording that, for example, a guitar would just not be recorded. You would just have like, da-da-da-da-da! That's what it would sound like. However, there's two things you can do. You can then decide not to use that song, or patch the holes, which is what we did. We did the patching of the holes because we wanted it to sound like a complete experience. However, we had a few rules. We're not going to overdo it. Play one take, you know, play it like you're playing it live. It shouldn't be perfect, and make it sound as homogeneous as possible. And honestly, most live albums you have in your collection have been tampered with. And this, the thing that we're describing right now, we're very conservative on that front. Short set, did we fix something? Yes. We just patched the holes because we figured that it would give us the opportunity to release a live album at all. Now, the final part of recording the audio side of things, obviously, is the mastering. And I was lucky to have a really, really good second person with me on mastering. Obviously, you saw the interview I did with Rich Hinks a few weeks ago, and that was great fun. Rich is a guy that I met relatively recently, and actually the live album was one of the first jobs we worked on together. And I just noticed that the way he thinks, the way I think, the way we interact with one another, and the ideas we have about sound really, yeah, they really match up. So it really was nice to have my mix and send that to someone who would have the same headspace. I'm really happy with the mastering that Rich did, which is another point which I cannot stress enough when doing a live record. Get it mastered. Don't just mix it, but let someone else do the mastering for you. I actually think this goes for every audio related thing you do. If you do a song in the studio, if you do a live song, or if you do a video or whatever, just make sure that you find people that you trust, who you know whose work is good enough, and ask them. I mixed this record for 4 months straight. At a certain point, you're just not hearing things anymore. And that's okay. I'm human. I'm not a robot. And then it's very nice to have a guy that does the mastering, which says, yeah, the hi-hat's a bit loud on that song. You might want to, you know, might want to turn it down. And then finally, we end up with the thing that was, well, the most time consuming for me, because obviously with the band, we did the whole audio part, but I've basically been working on this video pretty much nonstop for the last 4 months, I would say. The whole production process was about 8 months. It's been quite a job. Obviously, there's a lot of factors that come into making a good live video, and I'll be the first to admit that there were a few things that I would have done differently if I had the chance. That's more of a thing for myself. Right now, we were in this weird situation that the whole show took place and we couldn't find enough camera crew, so we worked with a limited crew who did an amazing job. I cannot stress enough how happy I am that Janneke and Alex and Rogier, that they all did the work that they did. Honestly, considering how we did this, we recorded the show, well, basically we said, okay, let's record the show. I brought the cameras, and about 2 days in advance, I knew if we actually had a crew or not. And the editing for a project like this is hard. Editing a multicam takes time, but especially for a long show, I mean, this is 1 hour and 20 minutes of footage. It was pretty exhausting, I have to admit. I did feel a sense of fulfillment every time I finished a song and I was able to look at it and go like, wow, yeah, okay, this looks like, you know, this looks like a live show. This looks like the way I want it to look. So in that sense, it's like, it is a lot of work, yes, and you gotta be slightly crazy to do this kind of stuff. But I do think that the work itself is the reward. It's like, even if no one would like this film, even if everyone would be like, oh, this movie sucks, then I'll still be happy with it myself, because I know about the amount of work that I've put in to actually get it to the point where it is now. To be fair, video, for me, audio, video, web design, all the things that I do, all revolve around the same thing, and that is that the process sometimes can be very tiring. It's hard work, there's a lot of time and man hours to put in to get a project like this going, but the moment you can deliver it, like what has happened last Friday, it's both the most stressful thing, but it's also one of the most rewarding moments ever, because you can say, I made this. And it might not, you know, nothing is ever perfect in my world. I always think things can be better, but I did make this and it's done now. And it's here for the world to see and to hear. Yeah, that is worth so much more and is also worth all the agony and frustration that sometimes comes along with producing something, because it's that sense of accomplishment that, well, I honestly cannot really find anywhere else. And now, obviously, the film is out there, we're waiting for reviews, so now, in a weird way, it's time for me to let go. This vlog right here, me answering, you know, some of these questions and talking about it, is basically the last thing I will do regarding this live album, because the label promo is going, we're waiting for reviews to come in, which is scary as f***, by the way. Honestly, I never get used to it. I've released a bunch of albums, and every time that I'm waiting for reviews, I'm like, because what if they hate it? You know, could also mean that someone listens to it, has a bad day, and goes like,
okay, this is a 5 out of 10, I hate it.
So far that hasn't happened yet, so I'm happy about that. There's always that thing in the back of your head going like, is it good enough? Is it good enough? Is it good enough? But weirdly enough, I talked to many musicians over the years, some of those who I really admire, and this is something that apparently never goes away. Waiting for reviews, waiting for that final thing is always scary. It's always a part of being slightly afraid, like, you know, like, what are they gonna say? So basically, I'm telling this to myself, but I'm also telling this to all the musicians out there who have a hard time with this period, with waiting for what is to come. It's okay. It's okay to be anxious about this. It's okay to feel this, because it's logical. Someone's judging your work. Someone's judging the thing that you've been working on for so long. So it makes sense that you feel something. Well, guys, that was the vlog for this time. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I know it was, I tried to make it a lot shorter and more compact, and I hope that there was something useful in it for all of you guys. I hope this might have inspired you to maybe get into some new equipment or try some new things with your band, because in the end, the reason why I'm doing this is hopefully to inspire people to get better at what they love doing the most. Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. Obviously, I want to do a shout out to the band members of Dreamwalkers Inc. for making this product happen as well, because in the end we did this together. It's something I honestly think we can be proud of. This I want to thank Rich for taking the time and, you know, putting the energy and effort in to really make this the product that it is right now. I want to thank my beloved Janneke for handling one of the cameras. I want to thank Alex and Rogier for handling the side cameras in the film. You guys really help with making this film so much better. Finally, I want to thank all of you guys for being at the live stream last Friday, for listening to the record, for sharing it, for, well, basically buying the CD, you know, all that stuff really helps, and it's heartwarming, really. So from the bottom of my heart, I can say thank you for supporting, and I really hope you like it. Feel free to share this vlog, feel free to share the live show. If you like this vlog, great, check out the live show. The link is in the description. It's the first link you can click on. It's really easy. Watch it, share it around to your friends, because the more people see it, the happier we will obviously be. And obviously, I hope to see you all at the next vlog, which will be in 2 weeks. So thank you, take care, stay safe, stay healthy, and stay prog.